soon. Well, if somebody had told me a couple of years ago that I would stand before an audience like this talking about education, I would have laughed. Because I was and I think my family too, especially my brothers, I was a very average student, but I was passionate with lots of subjects. And this passion made me move. And I'd like to ask you, what do you think, what crosses your mind when you heard the word education? And probably where you are standing in schools or vocational training, you would say school. And you are right. Well, partially right. Please hold this thought, and I promise you, you will revise it as we are crossing the world of education in the next couple of minutes. And I promise you that I will not talk about school or talk about education per se, but I will talk about learning. And I will dedicate this talk to all the learners we are. My first consideration is that every human on earth is constantly learning. So we might be very different, all of us, come from different countries, have different backgrounds, speak different languages, but we have one thing in common, and this is that we are constantly learning. And I would like you to represent the fact of learning as being an act of exploring a kind of landscape with different regions. And as we are in Luxembourg, this landscape could look like this. Have you seen the Philharmonie? It's a very nice concert hall in Luxembourg. Or do you see the cliffs of Müllertal? Müllertal is also a very famous spot in Luxembourg. It's also called Little Switzerland. Or perhaps you see the forests of Luxembourg with the trails. Or certainly you see also the lake, the Stausee. And this is a very famous vacation spot for the people in Luxembourg. So, the Müllertal represents formal learning, and formal learning is delivered by schools and by vocational training institutions, also by universities, and it's a kind of hierarchically structured and chronologically ordered lessons, and it leads to diplomas and certificates. But have you seen these deep cliffs, where they are difficult to climb and you need a lot of endurance and skill and knowledge and motivation to get on top of it? But every top you climb is worth looking for and has great views. And every attempt to climb the top must be valorized. You see the Philharmonie. Well, the Philharmonie stands for non-formal learning. This is kind of optional but organized learning that are delivered from institutions, organizations, associations, and you do it when you are at leisure. After work, it's piano lessons, it's a football training, it's a scouts, it's a concert. And all these activities, they would not help you in your calculus homework, but they are very essential for your development. The Stausee represents informal learning. And informal learning is this kind of unplanned, unintentional process of learning that you do on leisure with your family, with your friends. For instance, this TEDx evening is really a good example from informal learning. White learning would be represented by the forests of Luxembourg. You have many trails to be discovered. And this white learning is something that is very important. They are spontaneous and sometimes risky actions. And they are important for kids and for youngsters to get explored. Could you, for instance, imagine that you would live one day on Mumbai Street? Well, there are many kids in Mumbai that do not go to school, but that they know their way around, and they could teach us or many of us, a lesson of two. So this is the landscape of Luxembourg, and it represents the landmarks and the sites of Luxembourg, but it could be anywhere. It could be, for instance, if in Costa Rica you would see the rainforest, and the Swiss, they would be depict the Alps, but it's not, it doesn't mean where it is and what it looks like, but what it entails. And my point is that all of us are constantly crossing and meandering those regions of learning, and that they are all equally important. My second consideration is that every human on Earth is eager to learn. I think you know Obelix. Well, he fell into the pot of magic potion when he was a child. And this magic potion gave him this superhero force to ward off the Romans. And all of us have this force in us, this magical power, this curiosity and eagerness to learn. And this curiosity doesn't, we have it as from our childhood, because without any, we are also, all of us, potential scientists. As from the beginning of our birth, we are looking, we are like exploring our paths and the world. And this eagerness to learn doesn't end with childhood. It is a lifelong progress. So my third consideration is that who learns gets intelligent. And as we are all learning, we are all intelligent. For millions of years, our brains have been evolving, putting us on the top of the food chain. And we are so fond of our brains that we don't realize that we are getting to be dethroned by man-made machines and their artificial intelligence. A computer starts to learn, and who learns becomes intelligent. But what is intelligence, you might say? Well, most of you might say it's a kind of measurement of the intelligence quotient, the IQ. But this kind of measurement could never evaluate humans, the individual's capacity at its full extent. There are multiple, there are more types of intelligences. And Howard Gardner, who was an American psychologist, he spoke about multiple intelligences. But the Luo people in Kenya, they have another. They have another theory of intelligence. They distinguish four species of intelligence. Rico means knowledge. And skill. And that's a kind of intelligence that gets promoted in school. But the Luo people, they have three other kind of intelligences. Luo, Paro, and Vinjo. And Luo stands for respect and care of. Vinjo stands for understanding and comprehension, the disposition to share. It's something like empathy, and Paro represent the personal capacities, like innovativeness, and also the fact, the creativity, and also the fact to go through with your ideas. So this kind of intelligence meaning is like what we call emotional intelligence, to cope with our emotions, to understand them, and to cope also with the emotions of the people around us. To conclude, I would like to say, let's diversify our understanding of learning and of intelligence. Let's not only rely on RICO. Of course, RICO is very important and helped us develop rapidly COVID vaccines, and even probably will help us navigate the next pandemic. But there are other forms of intelligence, and we have to look for their benefits too. Morality, empathy, creativity, fantasy, humor. When we raise our kids, we should experience their many activities, indoor and outdoor activities, and tell them that they are learning activities, and that they, with their, these activities, cope with their emotions, because unlike machines, we human, we learn with emotions and feelings, with joy and sometimes with sadness, with deception, with fear. And all the more reason to strengthen our Luro, Vinjo, and Paro. If we acknowledge only one single selective aspect of learning and intelligence, our work, our world is at risk for poverty, for misinformation, for dictatorship, for inequality in education, and the lists go on. So our society, to progress, must rely on the wide range of intelligences and learning. And we have to commit it to. But who has to commit to? It's you. It's me. It's us. It's civil society as a whole. Because education needs society, and society needs education. And let's not forget the next generation. They can, if we only empower them to be the subject of their learning and of their life.
Ich kann Leithelfen.
Ich kann.
Je peux.
Ich kann.
Eu consigo.
Je peux.
Ich kann.
Je peux.
I can.
We can.
Je peux changer le monde.
Thank you.